Hey, good morning, everyone. I see we're already with a group of 15 to 20 students. We have some students still left to join, but because we have a lot of ground, I think, to cover this morning, I say we already can start off with a class and have other students just pop in the next couple of minutes and join us. As usual, I'll just go over some housekeeping rules. If insofar as possible, I would suggest everyone can turn on their video camera because it's a bit more fun and interactive that way to have today's lecture. Insofar as possible as well, I try to keep yourself on mute just so no interruptions or avoidances occur. And if you have any questions throughout the lecture, please feel free to pop these in the chat function, and we can compile all of these and have our guest speaker for today address these towards the end of the lecture. Now, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to our guest lecturer for today's and next week's lecture on Chinese contract law, Professor Jacques Herbos. He was a very well-accomplished legal professional and is specialized in international contract law, more specifically also the international sale of goods and construction law. Now, Professor Herbos studied law and economics at our university at Gaya Leuven, and then went on to study at Johns Hopkins in the United States. And he has been a professor at Lovanium University in Kinshasa, and also a professor at the Gaya Leuven, where he also went on to become the dean of our very own law faculty. Now, besides his various academic positions in Kinshasa, in Leuven, but also at other international universities where he has been a guest lecturer, he has also been a very accomplished legal professional as a judge, a deputy judge, for example. He has also been a member of the legislative section of the Belgian Council of State, and he has worked as an arbitrator. And he has also been a member of the High Council for the Judiciary. Now, where is his interest from China originating from? It actually originated very early on, as he's told me last week, ever since a visit apparently in 1974, which he told me was the very first visit by a legal professional group from Belgium to China. He has been fascinated by the country and also went on to study Chinese. And throughout the past couple of years, he has also continuously been a guest lecturer for this course on Chinese law. So I think we could not be in better hands for the next two lectures on Chinese contract law. Without further ado, I would like to pass on the word to you, Professor Herbos, and thank you very much for joining us again this year, although online.
Thank you very much, Melanie. This is very friendly of yours, too friendly. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. The ancient word for contracts in Chinese is the very ancient word. It's not an abstract notion, because that was not existing, but just a notion for a contract existing, sale of land, for instance. It's qi yue, qi yue. I write it down in pinyin, qi yue, qi yue. You have different terms to explain, to indicate contract. The one who became the most used word, and which is actually used now to indicate contract in law books, is hertong. The word, very strangely, comes from the practice when the paper was invented in China 2000 years ago, and then they started to write down contract on paper, and when the contract was signed, they would tear it in two parts. So one part he would take one part, and the other one the other part, tong. And so if there was a litigation, they had to bring it together to form then the arbitrator or the mediator, the judge, could see, read the whole text. See the tong. And that's the word which is used today. That's what I have to explain to you, is the hertongfa. The hertongfa, the fa, that's the law of contracts. So the law of contracts, that's what we will keep us busy for hours, is the hertongfa. So you had contracts long before the well, not perhaps long, but before already the Chinese writing came into existence slowly on 2,500 years ago, and one archaeologists find traces of that in ancient tombs. So, for instance, you have tombs of the Han Dynasty. The Han Dynasty is the first really magnificent dynasty in China. That was 200 years, it's easy to remember, 200 years before Christ till 200 years after Christ. 200 years before till 200 years after. So 400 years, the first dynasty, Han Dynasty, and tombs of that period, well, they found stone tablets indicating that obviously there was a contract for the sale of land. A piece of land was sold, and that was written on a stone, and they found it in a tomb. So you had contracts, of course, no problem, you had contracts. But the strange thing, and that's why I started with explaining that you had contracts, the strange thing for us Western lawyers is that you had no law of contracts. There was no law, no national written law on contracts, never. So from the Han Dynasty on, 200 before Christ, during the whole time of the imperial period in China, all the dynasties, till the Republic in 1912, you had no national law, you had no written law on contracts. Very strange for us. Why? Because we are accustomed, of course, to that. Since our first year in the law faculty, we learn about Roman law, we know. And Roman law, you know, it was first the law of a small village in Rome somewhere. But over centuries, it grew out to a learned and systematic system, also of private law. So you had a systematic, learned system of private law, which was rediscovered in Bologna. It was in Bologna in the 12th century after Christ, 12th century. And then in all the universities existing at that moment, slowly on, the universities rules, also University of Leuven, Coimbra, Prague, Paris, they start to teach Roman law. And Roman law became, in fact, the foundation of all the law systems of continental Europe. I say continental Europe because that's not true for England. That's a common law. I'll say a word on that later on. That's a common law. That's also the law which is in force in Hong Kong. But that has nothing to do with Roman law. But Roman law became a very important law system. And why do I remember you that? Because exactly what I said, in China, you had no thing like that. No system of private law. Very strange. How come? How come that you, it's worth to put the question, how come that you didn't have a law on contracts? Well, that's due to philosophy. From the 6th till the 3rd century in China, before Christ, you had a flowering of hundred of philosophical schools were flowering. That's very strange because the same happened at the same time, approximately, in Greece. In Greece, there was no contact between Greece and China. But at the same time, 6th century before Christ, you had philosophical schools. And in China, one of those philosophical schools is called now the Confucian school. This is because one of the founders of a philosophical school was Kung Tzu. Of course, later on, when the Jesuits arrived, the missionaries arrived in China in the 16th century, they made they changed the name in a Latin form. Jesuits, they would speak Latin, it was the language of those days, and they would say Confucius, but in fact it was Kung, Kungze. This family still exists, the descendants are still existing and are very honored in China. It's still a very famous family. Well, Kungze created that philosophical school, and he had a special attitude towards law, and that's the only thing that interests us lawyers here for the moment. That was this. He didn't like law. Law, and of course he thought of law because there was no private law. He only thought of the existing, the texts which exist at that moment were criminal law, the written. So criminal law, the written law of those days, the written law existing in those days, criminal law, that was something for rascals. That was something for social outcasts. The law was not for decent people. No, not for decent people. For decent people, you had ethics. He called it the Li. And it is difficult. Of course, I have to explain it in a few minutes, but for specialists, this is difficult to define. What is exactly the Li? Let me say it very shortly. The Li are the rules of social etiquette. The customary rules. How do decent people behave in society? Ethics, moral rules. That's the lead. And so he opposes Fa and Li. Decent people don't need law. Law is for the rascals. Decent people, they have to be educated. Education, that's very important. The education of young people to grow up as men, as you know, or women, although in those days, well, they that was important, the education, not law. And he that was very important for him, this distinction between the Li and the Fa. You certainly heard of that in your course on comparative law, the Li and the Fa. The Fa, the law, the Li, morals, ethics. And for centuries, up till now, that was the attitude of Chinese culture towards law. There was an aversion in China, a general aversion for law and courts of law, because you didn't go, and also you didn't go it. You had a private litigation with a neighbor, with another citizen. You didn't go to a court of law. That was for a court of law. You didn't enter that. That was for the rascals. You know, it was also very severe. The judge sitting there was very severe. Of course, it was mainly a criminal court. You didn't go to court. And even today, the people prefer, well, that's the idea, mediation. The mediation, an older people in a village, for instance, the elder, the chief of the village, perhaps, would mediate, try to arrange to find a compromise between the different interests of the litigants, mediation, not law, you know, a rule that you apply. No, you don't go to court. And that's very typical. I must stress that, but there, and this idea is still in the head of, even if a lawyer, because now they have, of course, law faculties, but if he will not tell you that, but he knows that that's the idea in the head of the Chinese law. That's not, you know, we call it law, or we adore the law, lex, not in China. And you don't go to get a court decision, you try to find an arrangement, mediation, but no court. That's very typical, characteristic for Confucianism. Now, saying that, And speaking, I used the term court of law, a court of law. What was a court of law in China? If you had no private law, what's a court of law? Well, I must here speak of court of law, say a word on the bureaucracy of China, Imperial China. We are still here speaking about the roots of China. I give you some historical facts. So why do I do that? Not because I love history, that too, but not, that's why I will not annoy you with that. If it were not that you find there the roots to understand the actual system, in the back of the actual system of Xi Jinping, you have this old Confucian ideas. They are there. What was a court of law? Well, in the long period of the Huns, 200 before Christ, till 2011 after Christ, so more than 2,000 years, there was an imperial history. You had an empire, and at the head, you had the chief of state. Well, if you can speak of a chief of state, but it was emperor. The emperor was at the center of the system. And that was a dynasty. And you had different dynasties, some very famous, the Sui, the Tang in, let's say, from the 6th till the 9th century after Christ, the Song, then the Ming, 13th, 14th century till 1644, and then the Qing. So Sui, Tang, Song, Ming, Qing, different dynasties. Very remarkable, there was a continuity. So during more than 2,000 years, you had a continuous tradition of an imperial system. An emperor in the capital, that was in the beginning Xi'an, but then slowly on it would change and it would become Beijing. But you had several times they moved there, but let's say you had the emperor in the capital, whatever it may be, where it may be. And this system of 2,000 years could only function because you had a very strong, very, very small, but very strong bureaucracy. That means that the whole administration of that huge and mighty empire was in the hands of a small group of very educated administrators. And these administrators, when the Jesuits, I spoke already of the Jesuits, when they arrived in the 16th century in China as missionary, they called them the Mandarins. That from the Portuguese, they were Jesuits, they were Portuguese first. They spoke Portuguese, and the mandao means to give orders. So they call them the mandarins, the people who gave the orders. That was this were the bureaucrats, the bureaucrats of whom I speak, the mandarins. And they were, how were they appointed? Well, you had a system, and this system is very famous in Asia, in whole Asia. They looked at that system. It's very, even today, with great admiration, people like that. A system of exams. You students will not like it, but well, at least normally, but exams. You had local exams in all little towns. Local exams, the guys it was only the guys who would succeed, would then participate to an exam on the regional level. And those who would succeed would finally go at the very prestigious exam in Beijing, when Beijing became the capital. And that was a national exam. And this was really the dream of the life of every Chinese mother and father. Oh, if my child could succeed in that exam, because then he would be a mighty Mandarin. And these exams, what did I have to study for that? That's a remarkable thing. Well, guess, what did I have to study for this exam? You would think French law. No law at all. Of course, they had to study Confucian philosophy, the classic literature of Confucian philosophy. That's what they had to study and then write it in beautiful handwriting. That was very important, the beautiful writing of the Chinese Han characters. And that was the exams. So the people who had the fate of China in their hands, the bureaucracy who was administrating China on behalf of the emperor, they were not lawyers. They were, in fact, very educated philosophers, if you want to. They very educated people, but certainly no lawyers. There was no legal education. And so if you had no legal education, you had no special class of lawyers like you had in Rome. Remember, in Rome, you had a class of lawyers. That was their job. Their job was to practice law, to give opinions about law, private law. And that's, they wrote books about that. And you know all the names, great names. Ulpianus, Paulus, Pomponius, Cicero, right? or as you may pronounce it, Cicero, those names. But you didn't have that in China. No Cicero, no Ulpianus, no Paulus, no Pomponius, no lawyers, no special law. There was no special class. So these mandarins, who had also, besides their task, very important task, very hard load of work, was administration. Irrigation, the irrigation projects, for instance, the roads, and so on, the administration. Besides that, they had to be also the judge in the Yamen. The Yamen was the house, the building where he sat when there was a court of law. In the Yamen, he had to be the judge too. So the administrator was also a judge, but that was a judge who had not studied law. So that is very funny for you. Well, funny. Very strange. Also, that's the last word about, on the imperial system. You had also, when I speak of the law, some of you may know and would say, well, what did she say there? There was no law. No, there was no written law, but you had in several dynasties, a code, very magnificent codes. Codes, for instance, in the time, the first one who started with it were the Tang in the 6th to 9th century, the Tang dynasty, a very magnificent dynasty. They had a special Tang code, and later you had a Song code, a Ming code, and then the last one, the last dynasty, the Qing dynasty, had of course also a code, the Qing code, and that's the very well known Da Qing Lu Li. Da means the great Qing for the Qing dynasty, Da Qing Lu Li, the code of the Qing dynasty, the big law book of the Qing dynasty, Da Qing Lu Li. And the Da Qing Lu Li, now you say, well, that's a code of law. Yes, but it had nothing to do with our civil law code, of which I will speak in the second lesson. Our civil code, which of course private law, you didn't find that in those imperial codes. It was mainly administrative law, so rules about the administration, the different ranks in bureaucracy and so on, how you could get promoted and administrative law and criminal law, all the what was forbidden, which were the different punishments and very cruel punishment. There you could be sliced in 100 pieces, about very cruel punishments, which were described in minutiae, in details in this code. So magnificent codes, but no private law at all. that you must have been, because I had some remarks already in earlier days of people say, but what are you talking? No law. What about the big codes? Yeah, big codes, magnificent codes. I agree with you, but no private law at all. Private law, civil law, was considered as of minor importance. That was the minor importance. That was not what interested the emperor. For the emperor, was what was important was the power of the state, his power, the state power, and the power of China, the empire. Civil litigation there between the citizens, that's of no importance. Minor matters. Now, last point about this law of courts in imperial time, but imperial time, you know, that's a long period, as you remember, from 200 before Christ till 2011 after Christ. So that's 2,200 years. That was the imperial history. But in those, what I told you up till now was about this period. Now, what you found also in that period, and that's the last thing I say about it, but it's important to understand the actual mentality of lawyers, is that you found in the handbooks for the magistrates, for the mandarins, and they had some handbooks. What do you do when you are a judge? They have a book to explain what do you do when you sit as a judge. You must be severe and so on. But there was a very important advice to the magistrates when they had to handle, let's say cases, even criminal cases. There was a sentence in the books which expressed the method of taking a judicial decision, taking a legal decision. And that was that the judge had to take due consideration of the concrete particularities of each case. He had to, first of all, understand the circumstances of the case and look at those concrete facts, not in abstracto, but the concrete facts of the case, look towards it with human feelings. That's what is called the Qing, also the same word, the Qing. And there is an adagium, a motto, which is still known today, which is as follows, and I like it very much. It's called, it said, He Qing, He Li, He Fa. He Qing, He Li, He Fa. What does it mean? Well, that's the advice which is given to the judge. He has to take three factors into consideration. And in order of importance, you come the first fact, that's He Qing, Qing. And Qing, that's the concrete circumstance of the case, exactly what happened. And look that you must understand what happened with human feelings, as I said already, with emotion, with a certain emotion, not abstract or from an abstract, in an abstract way, but just what happened there in concreto. For instance, a house was put into fire, but who did it? Why did he do that? Perhaps it, well, you know, all circumstances of the case, look at that. That's the first thing to do. Second thing, He Li. Then you look at those facts and you try to apply the rules of the, let's say to use the big word, the ethics. You would look at it, the Li in this case would mean in accord with what is right, what is just, and what is reasonable. Was it just to act like that? Was it reasonable to? So that's important. The what is right? It's right or bad. It's right or just reasonable. That's just where you just have to look at. And only on the third place, you look at the law file. The law comes on the third place. In that order, you look first with the human feelings to the facts. You take into account what is right, what is just, what is reasonable. And then, now, what does the law say about that? So it comes on the third place. It's completely different to what is taught in our faculties. In our faculties in the 19th century, the judge may not judge in equity. He must apply the written law. The written law, nothing than the written law. That's the theory. That's what they teach in the Faculty of Law. That's what I have to teach too in the Faculty of Law. Apply the law. You have to know the abstract law. Apply the law. Well, that's your task. Not so in the Imperial China, according to that motto. And you found it often in the law courts. You found it written with beautiful hand characters on the wall. He Qing, He Li, He Fa. And I think that's very characteristic for the Confucian philosophy. And when you know that in China, the whole Chinese culture is impregnated, is based on Confucianism, but also on two religions, Taoism and Buddhism. So Taoism, Buddhism, and Confucianism are the three, pillars of the Chinese culture. You don't understand Chinese culture if you don't understand Confucianism, if you don't understand what Tao means, Taoism and Buddhism. Now, the whole, that was the imperial time. The Qing dynasty finally came to its end. And that started already in the 19th century, in 1840. That was the Opium War. You all heard probably speak of the Opium War. That were the damn English, of course, who wanted to sell opium because they got it in India. They wanted to sell it in China. But in China, they said, no opium because that's bad for the people. And they were right, of course. But of course, the English wanted to sell, and it was war. So the bad English, if I may say so, it was colonialism. They started this war, opium war, and it was the beginning of what is called and what Xi Jinping today still calls the century of humiliation. Because China, who had been a very magnificent, very mighty empire, the whole world looked at it. It was very rich too, very rich. Just became second class country. The Opium War, and then it would continue. It would continue. The Western powers forced them to open different harbors. In the harbors, they became extraterritorial places where only Western law would apply. Chinese law would not apply. And in Shanghai, for instance, not. But that was really a century of humiliation who started. And so they started to think, the emperor, well, we must do something about it. We must become, I'll say it now in a very simple way, but we must become as strong as those Western devils. We must know how they do it. We must know how they arrive at being so mighty. For the whole might of the Western, it was the Industrial Revolution. Steel, the big ships, the big navy, the guns and so on. But they wanted to become as, and the same had happened a bit before in Japan. In Japan in 1868, you had a new dynasty, a very young dynasty, the Meiji dynasty in Japan, and they did the same. They said, that was the first example, the Chinese would imitate later on, 1905, they would imitate the Japanese. They would start to be dressed, you know, like Westerners, to take an external characteristic, you know, a bowl hat. But in law it meant, well, we must have something like the Westerns have, Western law. And so the idea was growing, we must westernize our law. We must modernize our law. And so there would be a mixture of domestic practices and foreign practices. In China, so imitating Japanese, the emperor that was at that moment in 1905, Guangxu, there was also an empress dowager, a woman which you know with long nails, that was the empress Cixi. Cixi was a terrible woman, but very mighty, but that was the in a shadow. You see them also in films, you see her. She's always behind the throne. You don't see it because they have a curtain. She's behind the throne. On the throne sits the emperor, and she's behind, say, exactly what he had to do. It was a weak emperor, Guangxu. By the way, he was poisoned by arsenic later on. But, well, Guangxu mandated a special commission in 1905 with handpicked legal experts, and they had as task to reform the Ta Qing Lu Li. Remember the Ta Qing Lu Li, the big code of the Qing dynasty? Well, reform that. We must have a new law, a modernized Western style law. And that was what this commission did. 1905, a revision commission. And what did they do? Well, they, for private law, but not only for private law, but also for private law, they, for law in general, they imitated what the Japanese had done in 1868. They imitated German law. In the beginning, in Japan, you had also some French diplomats and big shots in the French law, who had tried, and because there was also admiration for the French culture, they had tried to impose their view so that they would imitate the French Code Civil, but the Japanese had chosen for German law. I think that was because Germany was the strongest industrial nation at that moment, 19th century. They had won the war against France. They had won the war. They had a new civil code, the Bürgerliches Gesetzbuch, BGB, 1900. So in the eyes of the Japanese and later of the Chinese, Germans were stronger. And so they imitated, of course, the German law. And when they worked on that in that commission in 1905, that's what they did. It was mainly German law, also a bit of Swiss law, but that resembles a German law. In a certain way, Swiss law a bit, and of course seen through the filter of Japanese law. Having said that, because we are still in 1905, I must say, for those of you who don't know comparative law, but the lawyers have learned that in the course of comparative law, the notion of legal family. It means that in the comparative law, one group, all the law systems of the world in certain families. You have the Germanic family, the Romanistic family, the common law. You have different families. And well, in this framework of legal families, I may say that from 1905, where they choose for German law, this would continue. And we will see in the rest of the course that German law up till now, the new civil code of which I will speak in lesson 2, is based on mainly, it's a German tradition. I may say then, having used that word of legal family, that the Chinese, actually the Chinese system, in the modern Chinese system of law belongs to the Germanic legal family. Now, the code which they tried to draft in 2009 and the years after that, one of the big men behind it was a Chinese, very learned man with a beard, you know, typical Chinese Mandarin. He was called Shen Jiaben. Well, the code which they made never was enacted. It was never enacted. That was the first attempt, but it was never enacted. Reason being the Cixi, the empress, choosing the side of the traditionalists was against it. They were very traditional. And Cixi, well, she had poisoned the emperor, and she became then the mighty woman behind the curtain. She was against it. And also, I must say, it was too late because the Chinese revolutionaries were already complotting to try to send the Qing dynasty away, and that succeeded in 1911. The revolution broke out, and the Qing dynasty came to an end. You all know that because you saw the film of the last emperor the Italian big film, a little boy, Puji, the last emperor, came to an end, the Qing dynasty, in 1911. And 1912, the Republic, the first Chinese Republic, was declared. It was normal, as the Chinese say, the Qing had lost the mandate of the heaven. That's the Chinese way of saying things. Eh? The emperor was in power as long as he got a mandate from heaven. And when he lost the mandate of heaven, the dynasty would disappear. And that's what happened here. At what do you see it? Where you have different signals. For instance, in the 19th century here, you had the Taiping Revolution, Taiping Revolution in 1851. Then you had the war against Japan, who was lost by China, 1895. And then you have the Boxer Revolution, the rebellion of the Boxers in 1900. All those signs show that the mandate of heaven was lost, and so the Qing dynasty disappeared. So it was now time for a new period, the Republic. And the big man was Sun Yat-sen. Sun Yat-sen was a big man, and he founded the Kuomintang. Kuomintang, it's the party, the nationalistic party, which still exists in Taiwan, the Kuomintang. It means Tang party, Kuomin of the people. Kuomintang, he was founded by Sun Yat-sen in 1912. And after the revolution, you had a period of civil war with warlords, very difficult period. And the Kuomintang came to power only in 27 with Chiang Kai-shek. That was the Chiang Kai-shek took the place when Sun Yat-sen died. He took the place of chief of the nationalistic party, Kuomintang. And they came to the government, became a Kuomintang government in 1927. And he would be the government of China till 1949, when Mao Zedong comes to power after the war with Japan, after the Second World War. Now, under the nationalistic government of the Kuomintang, and that's the only thing I must mention here because I must care about law, not about general history, but in law, important is that when they came to power, 6 codes were enacted. So in 1928, a commission was created on the model of the Guangxu like Guangxu had done, create a commission with handpicked legal experts to draft a code. Well, they, here the same thing was done, and it came this time, it became a success, because in 1930, a code 2930, for remembering, it's easy to have 1930 in your head, 1930, that is the first civil code in China. It's enacted and it comes in force. 1930. This code, by the way, is still in force in Taiwan, because after the civil war, well, you know, when the Japanese attacked China during the Second World War, the communists, which existed as a party, a small party first since 21, they were created in Shanghai, and in a few months or years, that will be, well, a few months, yes, because it's this year, it will be remembered in China, because that's done 100 years ago that the Communist Party was created, but it was a very small party of revolutionary Marxists in Shanghai. They would become stronger and stronger under Mao Zedong. And they would, after the, well, during the war, they would so-called conciliation with the Nationalistic Party of Chiang Kai-shek. But that was only till the time that the Japs were, that they won the war. That they won the war against the Japanese. But once the Japanese were out and lost the war, the civil war started again. And now the nationalistic party, Chiang Kai-shek, they had to flee away. And they went to an island called, in those days, it was Formosa, still the Portuguese name, Formosa. It became then Taiwan. Which where you know what happened to Taiwan. It's now, well, I may not say it's let's say for the Chinese it's just a province of China. They consider themselves as an autonomous, not a region, but as really an independent country. But don't say that in Japan, or you finish in jail. Eh? And I don't say it neither. I don't say it. It's a part of the People's Republic of China. That's what the Chinese side says. But in Taiwan, so the Civil Code of 1930 is still in force. And of course, I told it already. It is essentially a copy of the German BGB, Bürgerliches Gesetzbuch. So the Civil Code of 1930, still in force in Taiwan, it's a copy essentially of the BGB, Bürgerliches Gesetzbuch. Also addition of a bit of Swiss law, some French law, some Japanese law, some Soviet law. And then comes 49, the time of Mao Zedong. When he comes to power, the 1st of October 49, the People's Republic of China is openly founded and declared. You see Mao on the big Tiananmen Square speaking with a very high pitched voice. He declares but it was a mighty man, very dangerous man too. He declares the People's Republic founded in a period of terror and extreme violence, it must be said. But well, that's for historians. One of the first acts of that new government, who now had the mandate of heaven, was to repeal all the laws of the which had been enacted during the Kuomintang period were repealed. So gone the civil code. We had the civil code gone. Bye bye. It's gone. All the laws repealed. One of the new laws, one of the first ones, is very typical, was in 1950, the marriage law, because that was marriage was still very much based on the patriarchal model of society, and that was suppressed. And that was a good thing, of course, if I may say so, for the ladies here in the room, it was a good thing. The old patriarchal ideas done, new marriage law, very, very, freedom loving, new marriage law. In the same year also, and then we come to contracts, you had some regulations on contracts, but not contracts between citizens, only contract between state-owned enterprises, between state-owned enterprises and between collectives. So between cooperatives, that's the word, cooperatives. But that, so contracts came into, they had to be regulated, but only in that sense. And mandatory state plan was imposed on the economy, a state plan, planned economy. The constitution, the first constitution of 1954, so 49, end of, 59, beginning of the People's Republic, 54, first constitution, a constitutional text based, it's a copy of the Soviet constitution. I must say that also in those days, there was a very big Soviet influence in law. So Russian professors came to the Chinese university to teach Soviet law. Students got the fellowships to go to Moscow to learn and to study the Soviet law, but that didn't last for a long time, 2 years, 3 years, and then it died away. It's finished. But the Constitution of 54 was on the Soviet model. Code civil, civil code. Twice there was an attempt to make one in that period. The first one in 54 also, and the second one, because that failed, and in 62, a second one, but that failed too. And why did it fail? Well, due to political turmoil. You may remember from your history course, perhaps, you had the period, very period of the movement against the right, against the rightists. Mao started a movement. First he had said, everyone may say what he thinks, right what you think, we are a free country. And then we knew exactly where what the people thought, against the right. And that was a terrible period. And then later on, there was another period, that was in 58, the great leap forward. He said, we must have an industry, someone than the English industry, steel. So every housewife had to bring kettles and so on, and they would found it. It was just a utopia. They tried to create from nothing an industry. It was called the Great Leap Forward. And now historians find out millions of people just died from starvation. They had not enough to eat. But that's history. The only thing I have to say here is the two attempts to have a civil code failed. So what means that we are in the Mao period. You still have a terrible disaster which is coming. That's from 66 till 76. That's the so-called Cultural Revolution, and that finishes only in 76, when Mao dies. God has his soul, he dies in 76. I was in China with some other Belgian professors, even before he died, that was the time of I was in China in 74. The first group, which was a Belgian group of law professors, which was allowed to China. I remember very well that period. You can't believe how China changed. I came back to China afterwards several times, also for the university here. China changed. Every time I came, I saw it was changed. It is terrible. The change, how China changed. You can't recognize it. When I was there in 74, no car at all. Sometimes you saw a black limousine for high bosses of the party, high party bosses, but that was only. All the people were in Mao, you know, dressed the same way. Also the women, I must say, the ladies, instead of having a nice dress, no, they had all this Mao, costumes, uniforms. Well, it was really, I was enthusiastic in those days, I must say. Now I say, well, but in those days, I must confess, I was very enthusiastic about the spirit, enthusiasm of all these people, you know, with a little book, Mao. Well, that was after he died in 76, and we had still no code civil, no civil code in China. I must say, during the Mao time, there was no law at all, no law at all. Terrible time, disaster. But of course, as a visitor, you didn't see that. Huh? And then after that of Mao, you had the opening of the country with Deng Xiaoping. A little man, Deng Xiaoping. His name is can indicate it's the Xiaoping. Xiao means little, and Ping is a bottle, so it's a little bottle. Deng, little bottle Deng, but a terrible man, terrible. And he is at the basis of the wonder which happened. From 78 on, the new economy of China, the new China, the new economy would start, and the law system which was restored. I see that my time. You see, I always speak much too much. Perhaps we could stop for 5 minutes. Let's stop for 5 minutes. So that you can a bit, and then we'll just 5 minutes because we have no time. Is that good, Melody? We just stop for five minutes.
That's perfect. We'll reconvene at 10:05.
Fine. Can we start again, Melanie?
Yeah, I think everyone will have returned. Go ahead, Professor.
Thank you. I only see one student, and that's Veronica Burgstaller. Hello. oh, I see another one. Elise Presley. Hello. Oh, no, I can't say hello to everybody. I say to everybody, hello. You know what the central committee of the Communist Party is? I must perhaps just tell you in a few words what it is. It's at the head of the Communist Party, you have the Central Committee. That's the mightiest organ of the party. It's the Central Committee, approximately to have a figure in your head, 200 people, Central Committee. And then above them you have the Politburo, that's 25 people. And in that, because the Central Committee comes only together once a year, the plenum once a year. So during the rest of the year you have the Politburo, 25 people, and for day-to-day activity, it's the Standing Committee of the Politburo, that's 7 people. So the 7 mightiest people, you see them when each 4 years you have the ceremony in the Tiananmen. Around Tiananmen, in the big building on the Tiananmen Place, you see them, 7 people will come up on the podium. Boom, 7 people, they come there because that the whole Congress will applaud that each year that they must be reconfirmed. And one of them is, of course, the Secretary General, that's Xi Jinping, who is Secretary General at the head. So, yeah, the head. Secretary General, he is member of the Standing Committee, 7 people. They are Standing Committee of the Politburo, 25 people. And the Politburo is the emanation of the Central Committee of the Communist Party. And now you'll say, and who elects the members, the 200 members of the Central Committee? Well, it's not an election, but they are appointed. The election, it's very secret. We don't know how that happened. It happens in the back rooms. But each 5 years, you have a national congress of the Communist Party. So the Communist Party, you must know the Communist Party. You know how many members they have? You have an idea? Communist Party, the party, is 80 million people. I have a Chinese daughter-in-law, and I know that her sister is, she is a member of the Communist Party. It's an honor to be a member of the Communist Party. Only you are chosen. It's not, you can't say, I become a member. No. You are co-opted to become a member. So 80 million, but 80 million, that's quite them. And the 80 million people, each 5 years, there's a congress of the congress who represents those members. And that's about 2,280 people. There's a congress each 5 years. But that's just for the facade. The real thing that don't happen there. They happen upstairs in the what I told you, the Central Committee and higher. That's where the power is. Now, why do I tell you that? Because in 1978, after the 11th session of the Central Committee of the Communist Party, it was decided that China would open the doors. So economic opening of the country, that's launched in 78. That's an important date. Remember, 70, the whole thing in China begins in 78. That's opening of the doors, starting of a new economy that starts in 78. And after this opening, that's the big man behind that is Xiaoping, Deng Xiaoping. De facto, he was a man. He he was the first revolutionary at the side of Mao Zedong, but then he was too critical, and he lost his power. He during the Cultural Revolution, his son was even thrown out of a window, and his son was his whole life in a wheelchair, paralyzed. Well, Deng Xiaoping, I can't tell you a lot of Deng Xiaoping, but that brings me too far. But it was important to know is that after 78, you have a plethora of laws, because we are private lawyers. As a private lawyer, that's what interests me. A plethora of private laws who come into existence. You can't imagine laws on patents, on copyrights, on trademarks, on marriage, on succession, on maritime law, on labor law, on procedure, the law of procedure. A lot of laws come into being in that period, well, after 78. On the law of contracts also, you have a law of contracts, very important up till now in this course. That was the only thing I did. I commented the law of contract of 1999, the Geurtong file of 1999, that was, we commented in the course, that was the law of contract, who came into being in 1999. Before that, you had had three laws who had prepared that. You had a law on economic contracts, but that's only for legal persons, for legal entity, for enterprises, state enterprises. Then that was in 81. Then in 85, one on the foreign contract, so contract with foreigners, foreign firm, Volkswagen or BMW, who would make a contract with a Chinese firm. That's under that law of 85. And then 87, that was a contract on technology transfers of technology. So after these three laws, economic law, economic contracts, foreign contracts, and technology contract, you had finally the law, the Geurtong file of 99. There was that, and I must say, because that's important for our codification, you had in 86 an attempt to start, 86, to start with a code of private law, a civil code, 86, but the time was not ripe, it didn't succeed, but it became then in 86, it was called the General Principles of Civil Law. So it was a law on the general principles of civil law, 1986. Because there was no civil, we had no civil code, so they had to start with basic principles. What is an obligation? What is a contract? What is a legal entity, a legal person, and so on. So fundamental principles. Well, it was a law with nine chapters in that law, nine chapters. And 156 articles, so it was, but it didn't include, it was a beginning. It was a beginning, but there the attempt stopped. But it was, we had already something up till now. That's the only thing we had, except that we will see that in 2017, so 4 years ago, they would retake that, and it would also be called the General Provisions of Civil Law. And then it would become the first book of the civil code, of which I will speak in a moment. Very important, in 1993, so after the opening in 78, in 93, you had the 14th session of the Central Committee of the Communist Party, and that committee would accept the principle of the socialist market economy. For an economist, this is simply contradictory. How can it be socialist and market? Because market, that means capitalist. So there's a socialist capitalist. What is that? Well, that's typical Chinese it's a capitalist system, eh? It's a capitalist system, but they call it social market economy. Well, that starts, the 14th Central Committee gives permission, green light, for the starting of the socialist market economy in 93. And then everything becomes possible. Everything is since then possible in China, everything, but look out, everything is possible if you respect the political orthodoxy, if you respect the power of the Communist Party. If you do that, everything is possible since 93. And then what happened for the contracts is, I told you already of the Gerdonck-Vaart, the law of contracts of 99, that the green light was given by the Standing Committee of the National People's Congress. Now you will say, what's that? Well, that's, you know, besides, because you have the Communist Party, that's one thing. But then you have the official state organs, according to the constitution. You have a government, that's called the State Council. You have parliament, that's called the National People's Congress. And so I look now at the National People's Congress, which of course they come only together once a year. So they have normally a standing committee, and it's a very mighty legislative organ, of course. Every law has to pass there before the standing committee of the National People's Congress. Well, the National People's Congress, after 93, the socialist market economy is allowed, they start to organize colloquia of lawyers, of judges, of university professors, to study. They give the great lines of a new law of contract. And it will be the law faculties who will make the text. And the text will be deposited in 95, will be presented in 95 to the standing committee. They will ask advice of foreign professors, for instance, American, well, not for instance, there were three. It was an American, Perillo, especially of the commercial code. Perillo, then Kronke, a German, Professor Kronke, and Professor Mike Ferguson, an Englishman who is specialist of Unidroit. The three gave advice. And then the project which had been made by the law faculties, after the advice of the foreigners, was sent to the provinces and to the autonomous regions to give advice. It's a bit like in the time of the French Code Civil, you know, when they was made in Paris, they were sent to the provincial parliaments to give advice. So they want to, because it must become a national law, the code, but here the law too, it's a beginning of, it's a start for contracts of the code. And then in 98, the final project, after all this preparatory work, is presented to the Standing Committee, who sends it to the National People's Congress, who voted it. It was the vote of the Gerdonck-Vaart, the 15th of March, 99. It was the first law which was for all the citizens. This was a contract law for all the citizens. Up till now, it was only for legal persons, enterprises, mainly state-owned enterprises. But now, this is a law for the people. For contracts is for all the people. And of course, I must say again, the German law is important. They, because what do they do to make that law, that law on the contracts in 99? They follow the example of the code who was repealed of 1930, the first code. They follow it, German tradition. And here there's something new, because besides the older lawyers who are still big, great fans of the German tradition, you have also younger lawyers who are also looking at the supranational instruments. I think here of the Vienna Convention on the International Sale of Goods. Vienna Convention. And secondly, the Unidroit principles of international commercial contracts. So the three texts, Unidroit, that's soft law only, and it's soft law, but very important soft law made by this intergovernmental organ, Unidroit, which has a seat in Rome. And then the Vienna Convention, which is not soft law, that's really applicable on international sale contracts. But they are very important also, those two texts. Besides the Code of 1930, you have these supranational instruments. Yeah. I must say that's important to note, that common law, where is common law? Aha, common law. And that's very strange, because common law is applicable in Hong Kong. Hong Kong, the old colony, who in 97 comes back to China, built them back to China in 97, becomes just a part of from the Chinese state. Well, you have in Hong Kong, the law which is applicable, still now, is common law, English common law. And you would think that would have influence then in Beijing. No, the common law has no influence on the private law of China. So especially for me on contract law. Well, you have some exceptions. For instance, they will, because it comes from the Vienna Convention and from the Unidroit principles, they will accept a common law institution, which is called anticipatory breach of contract. In anticipatory breach of contract, that's something which doesn't exist in the, for instance, in Belgian law, in the continental European law systems. Anticipatory breach of contract, that comes from the common law. So that's an example. So you have some examples coming from the common law, and further on, I will each time point out at the common law, because that's interesting to know. Because, you know, those of you who did comparative law will know that there's really a cleavage between the continental European systems and the common law. These are two different worlds. Continental law, well, to say it rudely, it's based on Roman law, principles of Roman law. The common law, not. That's based on the Middle Ages. Well, I mean, the Middle Ages, the system started in the Middle Ages and became a judge-made law. Right? That's something different. But what I said here is, sources on this contract law of 1990, German tradition, no common law tradition, no common law tradition. German tradition, no common law tradition, except eventually through the channel of the supranational instruments like the Vienna Convention or the Unidroit principles of commercial contracts, which were those supranational instruments, which were based which was based on comparative law. So they always try to find a compromise between continental concepts and common law concepts. That's what they did in the Vienna Convention, that's what they do in the Unidroit. They always try to find solutions, to have rules which can be accepted, which are acceptable in the common law world and in the civil law systems. And then, having said that, I think I can start with the code, the civil code, actual civil code. We said, before we interrupted for 5 minutes, that you had had attempts during the Mao time to make a civil code, another kind of civil code, of course, because it was very Marxist-Leninistic. But at least you had an attempt, but it failed. But in 1998, in a new period after Deng Xiaoping, you have the Standing Committee of the National People's Congress, who decided to start the codification process to start it again with a clean slate, with a clean slate. And this time the efforts would succeed. The codification efforts, we will see it, it will take time, right? It will take time, but it will, they start in 98, but it will take 22 years before having the result that the code comes into existence in 2020. And so indeed, the 28th of May, 2020, the National People Congress adopted the new civil code. And it became effective, it came into force the 1st of January of this year, 1921. So you are, it's really fresh. It's like the bread which comes out of the oven. It's served very fresh to you. It's a code, and I will speak of it, who came into force this year, the 1st of January. And a code is the first, is the only statute, the only law which bears the name of code in China, actually. Code, it means in Chinese, again, you have fa, fa, hello, fa dian, fa dian. Fa dian. See, fa dian, you see it? Fa dian, that means code. And what does it do? It tries to integrate, of course, that's the meaning of a civil code in the country. It means to integrate all the existing legal norms in the field of civil matters. It had been a long-cherished wish, a long-cherished dream of generations of civil law lawyers to formulate a code following the codification tradition of European law, of continental European law. Not the common law, the common law hates codes, but in civil law countries, it was always France, it started with France, a dream to have a code, a code civil, 1804, code civil in France. And then Germany, they would have their Bürgerliches Gesetzbuch, in 1900, nearly a century later, the German one. That's the dream, to have all the rules which govern civil life, life of civil normal citizens, must be governed by rules which are gathered, integrated in one big book, in one code. That was their dream. And the difference between France and Germany is that there it could happen very quickly, you know, in start. Napoleon decided, no, we will have a code. Of course, you had a commission, a few years later, the code was there. Same in Germany. When Germany was unified, the law circles, they thought, well, we need to have, like those then French, we will have our own code. So they start to work on that, and very quickly, pop! They had it, not so in China. There's a difference. It would take years. And I can divide the period between 98, when the Standing Committee of the National People's Congress decided we should have a code, and we start with it from then on till now. I can divide it in two parts. First part is that each branch of the civil law, for instance, the contract law, the tort law, property, the real rights, the rights in rem, so ownership, and so on, succession, each field apart would be legislated on. So you would have, for instance, in 99, the law on contracts already in 99. And to take the law of property, that was 2007. To take the law of torts, that's for 2009. So you had, since, let's say, I may even take it a bit earlier, since 86, since 1986. Remember, 1986, the general principles of civil law. Since then on, you had several different separate laws. Who would all go in the direction of a civil code? They were not a civil code, but part of. They were all parts of preparing to the civil code. And then you have second period, 2014. There, the Central Committee, we have it again, Central Committee of the Communist Party, called for a compilation of all those laws. They said, no, it's enough. We must have a code. But of course, they don't do it themselves, of course. Central, they are the Communist Party. They don't do the work themselves. They just said, we should have a code, 2014. So at that moment, civil code, the unified civil code, was on the political agenda. It became a political question. We must have a civil code. And so first thing they did was in 2017, I mentioned it already, you have the general provisions of civil law, like it had been in 86, the general principles, no, general provisions, something like that. And you say, well, why did they do it? Well, because in the German civil code, you have a first book, the first book of the different books forming the civil code, the German civil code, you have a first book there, it's called the, how do they call it again? The Allgemeine Teil of the BGW. And that's what is done in the act of 2017, the general provisions of civil law. And then you have also what happens is you have the organized open consultation. So the public, not only the provincial government and so on, but the public, general public, millions of people may say what they think by email, send what they think about the project. And for instance, I just mentioned two examples because they are very popular. For instance, the women organization, I see a lot of women here in the classroom, the women's organization, they were all very critical about a new proposal of the cooling off period before the divorce. So when you have a divorce, the people start the divorce. Now there's a new rule which is proposed in the civil code and which was accepted, in fact, to have a cooling off period. Before, you must cool off during 30 days. Now all the women organizations, again, because of course you have a lot of violence in families, and they stress that in violent situations in families, or the man is having mistresses, having other women in his life. They say, why cooling off here? So, an example. Another example, you had the proponents of the same-sex marriage. So, same-sex marriage. They said, why don't we have that in the civil code? Other countries have that. That was not accepted. So you don't have same-sex marriage in the new civil code. But you see, there was discussion also in the public in general. And then, as I said, the 28th of May, the National People Congress voted the civil code. That was a real happening. In comparative law, it was a bit, it didn't get too much attention due to, I'm sorry to say, to the COVID-19 virus. All the media speak only of COVID-19, Corona, and so nobody looked at something that happened the 28th of May, 2020, a new civil code in China. It became effective just one, a few months ago. And of course, the same day, all the existing laws, like the law of contract, the Hertogvaart of 99, or the act on the property law, or the marriage act, or the succession act, all the existing law were repealed. They disappear. They are replaced now. There is now one civil code. And that one civil code is divided in seven books. It's typical the civil law tradition. The code is divided in books, and they follow, in fact, the German example. You have book one, Allgemeiner Teil BGB. So it's called in Chinese the general provisions. For instance, we are made on agency, that a person who is performing a juristic act can be represented by someone who represents him and performs the civil act in his place. So the problem of what we call the legal representation, that's what you, the kind of things you find in the general provisions. Then book two, important, why? For ideological reasons, property, ownership. That's book two. That's in a communist country, ownership. Book two. Third book, that's our book, contracts. Ah, the contracts, third book of the civil code. Then very new, you have book four on the personality right on health, on life, on privacy, and the personality rights. Book five, family law, marriage, divorce, adoption, and so on. Book six, succession. And book seven, torts, so civil liability. An important feature of the civil code is its effort to legitimize private law, to legitimize private ownership, private property. For the first time in the history of communist China, state interests and individual private interests are treated equally. Let's say a word about that, because fundamentally this is important. Unlike what happened in Russia, there were no great scale, large scale privatizations in China. So remember, in China after 89, after the falling out each other of the old Soviet Empire, after 99, there were massive privatizations in Russia. But nothing like that happened in China. You had no large-scale privatization. You had something different. You had, besides the state economy, the public, socialist public state economy, you have a private economy which develops outside the state sector. And they develop without any legal or ideological certainty. Can we do that? They remember what happened in the Mao time. Can we start a private enterprise? But they do it. And so there's a private sector, economy sector, which develops outside the state sector. Of course, there is no, in the beginning, that it will slowly on change, but in the beginning there is no ideological certainty. Can you do it? Is it correct to do that or not? And you know, the recognition of private ownership, and it's normal in a communist regime, has always been a major ideological hurdle for the lawmakers. For the lawmakers, it was always a hurdle. You know, in 1954, Mao time, 1954, the first constitution, it was already, the goal was fixed by Mao. Private ownership must disappear. It must be transformed into socialist public ownership. That was a principle in the 54 constitution. But later on, 56, you see, you have a different government regulations, and all private enterprises must be changed. That they concretize what was said in the constitution. They must, no private enterprise anymore, they must be changed. And in the beginning, it was in private state joint ventures, public private joint venture. But very soon it became only public, state owned enterprises. So all the private enterprises appear, only state enterprises stayed. And the constitution, the constitution still in the time of Mao, the new constitution of 75, just gave no protection at all anymore to private ownership. So only public ownership was inviolable, was protected. This changed, of course, after 78. 78, remember Deng Xiaoping, the socialist market economy. There is now a shift, slowly on, a shift towards protection of private economy. And in the constitution, I forgot to tell you that after Deng Xiaoping, there was a new constitution, 82. The constitution of 1982 is still the actual constitution. Eh? We were now in 2021. It's still the constitution of 82, which is enforced. But it was since then four times amended. There was an amendment of the constitution four times, but it's still the text of 82. Well, the an amendment, the first amendment of 88, said that, well, the private economy may exist, may develop besides the public economy. And slowly on, it was, well, the private economy may be regarded as a complement of the social public economy, as a complement. In a constitutional amendment of 99, it's even more. The private sector is considered as a major component of the economy. And then you have the constitutional amendment of 2004, that's the last step. Private ownership is inviolable. You can't violate private ownership. Nobody may infringe the individual ownership. So that's the principle of in the constitution of, well, constitutional amendment of 2004. That's then completely reversed to what was said in the time of Mao, 1975. Only public ownership is inviolable. Now the private ownership is also inviolable. And just to make you understand how fantastic this development is to follow, is that by explaining you how the Property Act of 2007 came into being. So the Property Act of 2007, so before before the Civil Code, 2007, one of the first acts, like the Act of 99 on contracts, you had 2007 on property, that was deposited before the Standing Committee of the National People's Congress in 94. And it took 14 years to become law in 2007. How come it took so much time? It's because, you know, you must imagine the heated discussions in the commission preparing this text between the Marxist-Leninistic fanatical defenders of the pure theory, the pure Marxist theory, for those people, you ownership, private ownership is just anathema, it's a devil. Well, they don't believe in the devil, but for them it's a devil, private ownership. But then the others say, well, no, for the economy it's necessary and so on. The economy must grow. Terrible, 40 years. It explains you what happened. And when you see what I told you, you know, in 1975 in Mao, no ownership will not be protected. And then the constitutional amendment of 2004, private ownership is protected. You know, it's not so much time altogether. And so, no, actually, in fact, the private economy, let me say it that way, I think of Jack Ma with his famous, his enterprise like Amazon, he imitated that, fantastic guy, Jack Ma. But of course, he learned that he had to respect the Communist Party because they nearly got him last year. But he learned that, I think, his lesson. But it's a good example of private enterprise, which is extremely, becomes a private enterprise which becomes extremely mighty and rich, and which is protected by the law. As long as I told you, as you respect the Communist Party, so it will not astonish you that in Article, then we are back to our code, the Civil Code, that in Article 2007 of the Civil Code, the property rights is recognized as a right which is equal to the ownership of the state enterprises. So the text of 2007, Article 2007 says, property rights of the state, of collectives, and of private individuals receive equal protection under the law. No organization or individual shall infringe these rights. So I think this is an important feature of the Civil Code, this legitimization of the private law. Now, more technical, in contrast to the civilian tradition, there is, you heard it, no book. Did you notice that? No book on obligations. No book on obligations. No. You have a book on contracts, book 3, and you have a book on torts, book 7. So torts and contracts, they are two sources of obligations in our system, in the European continental system. In Belgian law, for instance, you have verbindingsrecht van dat soort instance, and you have in verbindingsrecht van dat soort instance, she teaches contracts and torts, contracts and onrechtmatige daad. It's all in the same course. Not so between brackets in the common law. In England, it's not like that. They don't have the legal term of obligation. Well, they understand what it means, But it's not a technical concept of the law obligation. You have contracts and you have torts. Now, in fact, you have a bit, it's not the same as in the common law, because of course the Chinese law has the technical term of obligation. They use it. Obligation is an important legal term. What is an obligation? And it's important. But they have two separate books. It's the first time that happens. That's something new. Just a word, because it's not my field here. Just a word about the law of torts. In contrast to the common law, where you have different torts, you have torts, you have trespass, you have negligence, and so on. You have different torts. You have in the Chinese code, like you have in the French code, one general principle. One general principle, our article 1382, article 1382, 33. In the new French code, because you know that the French code was modified. It's now, there's always difficulty, they change the numbers. So you are accustomed to it. And in France, it was also 1382, but now it becomes 1240, article 1240 and 1241. But there you have a general fold liability. If someone commits a fold, which is in relation, in causal relation to a damage, the one who caused the damage through his fault must compensate the damage. And that's one general principle. That's what you have also in the civil, in the Chinese civil code. That's important to that's a difference also with the German code. They follow here the French tradition. And something new is now they follow also something you have in the French code and also in the Belgian code, when you have the strict liability of the owner of a thing which falls when you threw a flower pot out of the window and falls on the well, it just falls on the street, not because you throw it, because of the wind blows it away and it falls on the street and it injures someone, you are liable. In China too, you have now a new article on liability, strict liability for falling objects. And then I say it for all the nice ladies I see before my eyes here, in not to the Me Too movement, Me Too, article 1010, obliges companies to adopt measures for preventing and responding to sexual harassment in workplaces and also in schools. They are also in schools. And these include channels for complaints, procedures for investigating complaints, and rules for disciplining wrongdoers. That's something new, but that's for torts. Then a word about, to stay in the law of obligations, about quasi-contracts. That's something completely new. It didn't exist until now in Chinese law. They treat two general principles, which we call in our law, unjust enrichment. Unjust enrichment, onrechtmatige verrijking zonder oorzaak. Unjust enrichment, they have it now. They introduce a quasi-contract, unjust enrichment, and they do that in book three on contracts. So in book three on contracts, you have the first part of book three. That's the general theory of obligations, contractual obligations. That's what Sophie Stans teaches in Leuven, the general theory of law of contracts. Then you have a second subpart, the nominated contracts, the benoemde overeenkomsten, the different contracts, And then you have a third part that's new in China now, the quasi contracts, enriched enrichment, and also the negociorum gestio, Zaakwaarneming, negociorum gestio. I could translate that in English approximately because it doesn't exist in English in the common law, but I could translate it as agency without a mandate, agency without instructions given by a mandatory. That's I'll give you an example of that just in a second. The example of the Good Samaritan is a good example to explain you the negociorum gestio. But let me first say then, before I give that example, that the quasi-contracts, which between brackets are no contracts at all, for those of you who are no lawyers, quasi-contracts, they are no contracts at all. But quasi-contracts, they are unknown in the common law. England common law, English common law doesn't know that notion of quasi-contract. And so, ladies and gentlemen, take the opportunity to stress here that they are unknown. This is unknown too in Hong Kong. I told you already, Hong Kong, the code, the civil code, is not applicable in Hong Kong. It's not applicable in Hong Kong. In Hong Kong, you have the English common law, which is applicable. And the same is true for Macau. Macau, there is the old Portuguese law, which is still now applicable, and not the civil code. I wanted to stress that. And now I give you the example of the Good Samaritan. It's an example to show you about to explain you the notion of a negociorum gestio. You had two, and it's good to explain you how it comes that they speak of Good Samaritan, because the code, you know, is the Chinese code is very pedagogical means. They try to make it understand to the people. And so why did they speak here when they explain the negociorum gestio? Well, they don't call it like that, but because there had been in the social media in China a lot of discussion about this problem of the Good Samaritans. About what does it go? Well, you had in 2006 an incident where Mr. Peng Yu helped someone who was injured on the road. There was a road accident, and he came, he helped him. He was a Good Samaritan, he helped him. But what happened then? They accused him of having injured the... So it's dangerous in China. It was dangerous to help someone because you had almost the risk that they would say, well, you are liable. But I tried to help. You are liable. Well, now, you had another incident, and that made, I remember that I read it in The Economist. In The Economist, they mentioned it so many years ago, this incident, so because it made a lot of noise in China. And there was also another incident where the little boy, Wang Yue, a toddler, who was run over by a vehicle, an auto, and then a second car ran him over too. And it's filmed on video. Well, there was obviously someone who filmed it. And then they send it on the, on the internet. So all China saw it. And what happened was 18 people passed by. Nobody stopped. Nobody stopped to help. They could have jumped and tried to, no, but 18 people. So this was a terrible news. And so now they had to do something about that. It's a good example of, I know that you don't know your Bible, but in the Bible you have this famous story, you should know that, of the Good Samaritan. I will not explain you the Bible, but Now, what do they do, the Chinese legislator? In 2017, remember 2017, the general principles, the general provisions of civil law, they added an article 184 and saying that someone who voluntarily would carry out emergency assistance, and by doing that he would cause harm. It could be that you cause harm. You try to help, and you turn his head. You should have done that. You are not a doctor. You don't know that. You don't, and you harm the victim. Well, said the article 184, you will not be liable. You will not be considered. You will not bear civil liability. That's already something. Of course, you have many civil law systems like the Belgian one who imposes more than that. He imposes a duty to help. In our Belgian code, you have article 422 bis of the criminal code who says you are obliged to help someone who is in great danger if it's without danger for yourself or for others. You are obliged. They don't go that far in China, but they say at least, well, you are perhaps not obliged, but if you do it, you will never be considered as responsible. And then more than that, and now I come to negotiorum gestio. If you do that, you help someone. So you didn't get an instruction. That's why it's called the negotiorum gestio. You did it just out of your own will. You wanted to help. And you help it, and you are yourself injured. You get yourself damaged. Your clothes are destroyed, or you have expenses. Well, you can get them back, and that's a new remedy which is given by that quasi contract negotiorum gestio. I see that, Melanie, that my time is up. Should I stop here?
Maybe, yes. I think some students also have to go to a next class, likely, that's starting at 11. But maybe we can pick up then next week as well. And if the students have any questions, you can also feel free to compile them and send them by email. And then we can address them next week or have another moment that we can address those, if that's all right for you, Professor.
Excellent, excellent.
Yeah.
But I need really more time. We would ask you to, Professor Wouters.
I know, we need to take care of that. Thank you very much for today's class. It was very interesting for you to take us already through the legal developments since imperialism, and then an introduction to the civil code.
Thank you. You can always also send me an email. Melanie will give you will transmit your my number. It's very easy, Jacques Herbots at KU Leuven, like anyone in the university.
Yeah, I'll definitely share that with the students as well.
You do that. Or you ask it to Melanie, she will transmit it. Thank you very much and see you next week.
All right. Thank you very much. Bye. See you next week.